has done some large outdoor murals, also in Worcester and in Providence, which I just thought was fascinating. And he teaches at the Bancroft School in Worcester, and in the summer he teaches classes at the Worcester Art Museum. And Tom has graduated, he's got a BFA from Rhode Island School of Design, and his MFA from Lesley University. So let's give a welcome to Tom Grady.
Thanks, Diane. Thanks for inviting me, and happy to be here. Glad you guys were able to make it out in between storms. I'm going to work on this painting here for you guys today. I kind of started it already, so I would have this hour and a half, right? So paintings usually take, oh, I don't know, painting this size, maybe I'd work on it for 8 hours or so. So it takes time. So trying to decide what to do in this hour and a half. And I figured I'd take care of the underpainting. So I just did an underpainting in black and white. And it's on just a wood panel that's gesso. And the yellow is just a yellow ground. So usually everything, before I paint, I'll just tone the ground color. It really doesn't matter. Usually it's a neutral color, like a yellow ochre or a sienna, just to get rid of the white. And then heighten the white, some of the highlights, and just knock back some of the shadows. At that stage in the painting, it's perfect for working on like the drawing, just trying to get everything right. So sometimes it's nice to separate mixing the color and the drawing part, because the two at the same time can be challenging. So, start with the underpainting, get that squared away, and then you can think about color once the drawing and the composition's all set. I have this technique. I haven't really brought it out to show us at a demonstration yet, but I use my computer quite a bit in the painting process. And one of the other challenges, in doing a demonstration is subject matter, right? What's the subject matter going to be? How am I going to transport? Is it going to be life? Am I going to work with a photo? You expressed interest in that domestic list series
yes.
that we're working on.
Right? Yes.
So I tried to find something in that area to work on here today. So I have a photo in this domestic list series that I've been working on since I think when I started when I got married. Something. I just started painting my family, my house, the backyard, just things in the house that I know that I'm around all the time. Right? So that I brought a couple in. A few years ago, but it's just something that I always continue to do. Like I have other paintings that I do, like portraits and some landscapes and some other things, but I always come back to do these sort of domestic paintings, just backyard stuff kind of thing in the house. So I have a picture here of my wife laying in the sun. I don't think she knew I took the picture. She'd be surprised, I think. But she's been a subject of a lot of my kids too, and my kids as well. So the nice thing, with having the computer here, I can zoom in on areas. If you have, a photograph, it's hard to do sometimes. So, if I'm working on the hand, I can zoom in on the hand. I can zoom out pretty easily.
I'm sorry, could you move the easel? No, okay. Move the easel to the left just about a foot.
Plus it gives great color, right? So when you make a print, usually the color's a little darker. So I was kind of from looking at the computer, trying to match the color there, I get better color in my painting. So, at least when I'm working from a photograph. Alright, so next step would be my palette. This is just a portable palette with a lid, and I'm gonna put some paint down.
One of the biggest questions I get
when teaching is how do I mix skin tones?
Yes.
You haven't done that, so I'll start with skin tones. Okay. Let's see colors first.
Are you working in green or are you
looking? This is oil paint.
Well, I'm sorry, blue or?
No.
This is, yeah, there's more oils.
Do you like any special brand, Tom? Oil paint?
I do. I get the M Graham. Which is sold at CC Lowell. Mm-hmm. I really like it. And it's a good price, it's not too expensive, and it's a great quality. And certain colors are more expensive than others. But I have some favorites, you know, like the cadmium red, cadmium green is great. I don't have a cadmium green. In this set, my direction is running out, so I'm going to mix one. I love cadmium orange. And cad red, cad orange, cadmium yellow, and dioxazine purple. Do you guys use oil paint? Do you guys use oil paints?
Yeah. Are you involved with the non-toxic cadmiums? Are those, you know, not poisonous?
Oh, yeah. Really? Is it made of cadmium?
I don't know what it's worth to me.
Yeah. Yeah, cadmiums. I guess it can cause problems if you ingest it. I guess they don't have that pliers on
pliers? The pliers? Yeah, sure we do. I'm sure we do.
You know, you come prepared. I try to prepare. I'm like, okay, I got this and this, and I got all my colors. And I didn't think about bringing my pliers.
Ella's going to go get some.
That's great. But I want this purple. You pass it around. Give it money. Try. Sort of the stone.
You can always do what my mother used to do. She painted as well. She kept an old pair of nutcrackers in her.
Oh, yeah.
For just that purpose.
Yeah, on that, that works.
Managed to melt it.
Yeah.
Okay. Flyers. Anybody else want to give it a try?
Sealed.
Come on, Diane. Get in there. Show some muscle.
No, I put everything under hot water.
Yeah, hot water. Oh,
here she
goes. Oh, fire. Yeah. The lid's just like a little
too
small.
I get the
hammers
too.
Yeah. That way you make it small.
Yellow green in the palette. what I'll do is take that yellow green and mix the cadmium red.
You choose a little bit of red?
Let's see here.
Yeah.
Maybe a 1-to-1.
Oh, okay.
That's a good starting point, right? I can't hold the palette like this in mixed green the whole time.
No, that's okay.
I'll put the palette here, I'll pull it up and show you a few things, you know, as I go. Where do I want to start? Probably the shadows, you know. It's weird when you do a demonstration for people, because then you really got to think through what you're doing in your process. So like, I don't think about it, just go and do it. Now I don't think about it, and I'm like, all right, well, I guess the shadows. We'll start with the shadows. Let's see, this arm. I'll start with that arm, because it has some light and shadow on it. Right here. Now, one thing that can be helpful with the computer is that I have a little tool called an eyedropper, and I can kind of isolate the color, you know, and see it like that, and then make a comparison to the light color. So sometimes it's helpful to, you know, even zoom in and just see the color isolated. I can click on this and see where it falls on spectrum. So, anyways. I'll try to get that shadow color on the arm.
Now, could you tilt the easel ever so slightly this way? Just yeah. Tilt it this way a little bit. Oh,
is that too far? Sometimes it's let me know, we can move it around as I go, too. So I'm just gonna paint. Things come up, I'll talk. If you have questions, ask questions. So I'm just adding some more red to this mix. So if you have like cadmium red, it's a little bit on the warm side, right? It's close to orange, and then you have that yellow green, which has a lot of yellow in it, right? It's still green. So when you mix that yellow green with that red orange, you get like a warm brown, but it's a nice kind of rich brown. It has a lot of warmth to it, you know? So it's a good start for skin tones. And then, yeah, it's a little on the orange side. I have warm light coming in, so the light itself is like direct sunlight. So it's a little warm. So I want to cool this down to have a little bit of cool shadow. So maybe I take a touch of purple. Some purple in there. Cool it down. And I'll tell students, you know, most of your time painting is not painting. Mm-hmm. Most of the time when you're making a painting, it's mixing color. Mm-hmm. Just call it. Color mixing, a splash of painting. Because you spend most of your time at the palette trying to get the color right. Where when you're drawing, you know, the whole thing is drawing. You're just drawing, not worrying about mixing color. Added some white to it also. That white will help cool it down. Color temperature. Okay, I got something. Okay. Mall stick.
You guys ever hear of a mall stick?
Yeah. It just slipped my mind too, you know. I got them all over my studio.
It's
okay. I can steady my hand. As soon as I went to paint, I'm like, oh, shit. That's okay.
You probably have something.
Yeah, I can get it. Put it down and then try not to fuss too much over it, especially at the beginning, because your colors might look weird to start with because it's not placed in context. So the color out of context might look wrong, but you just got to trust that you observed it, you mixed it, and you got it in the right spot. So keep moving. Here it gets a little darker, so I might take some of that darker color.
You're not an expressionist or impressionist. You're not
I guess
impressionist.
I don't know.
You don't think like this.
No, not an expression. Not an expressionist.
That you like to work on, Tom?
Yeah, I mean, I like the square, mm-hmm. So I work with the square a lot. I like working big. I thought for the demonstration, this would be better for your time frame.
Yeah.
So some of my other paintings, you know, these would be like, I could see this being a little study for a larger painting. I might make it life size. So I like working life size with figures. You know, so to have a full figure life size, you'd almost need like a 4x5 foot. Right? canvas. I have a few of those, you know, and I prefer that. Working life size, it's tough because storage is a problem, stuff like that. So, recently, I just started working a little smaller because of that. So I just finished 100 views of Worcester, which were all this size, 12 by 12.
You know, you're exhibiting that?
Yeah, that was exhibited last year, or in last summer, at Arts Worcester. There'll be a few more up at a corporate display. But right now they're all in my studio. Try to see the shape of the light and the shadow. It's all about shape. So you try to forget, almost imagine that you don't know what anything is. Like you're an alien from another world and you're seeing everything for the first time. You don't have words for anything. You're just trying to describe things through shape, right? Like shape of light and shadow. And just try to forget any preconceptions you might have, certain things like what looks like. Just try to draw the shapes, so get the shape right, the color right. And a lot of times when I do portraits, they're like, oh, how did you capture that essence of that person? Very metaphysical, you know, about the sort of the soul showing through the vein. You know, I don't even think of that. I think of just trying to get it right. It's like, did I get the drawing right? Color, you know, match, that stuff shows through because that's already in there, associated with that likeness of that person. So, I don't have to overthink that part. Alright. Typically, so if I have a color, like to stay with that color, work through the whole painting where that color shows up, right? So, you know, it's in the shadow on the skin, so it's like, all right, my palette's set up for skin tone shadows. So I'm gonna kind of go with that for a little bit. Thank you. started a new job at Bancroft School in September. I've been teaching there just 6 months. And that's been pretty good. We just got some oil paints from the students today. Actually, I had them do a painting, limited brushstroke painting, where I challenged them to use just 20 brushstrokes to make a painting of a donut. The big brush, so you gotta count your brushstrokes. Be deliberate, right? Because sometimes there's a tendency for them to put paint on and just keep blending it, blending it, blending it, and then everything's like all the same, you know? And it's just, like, you know, sometimes with beginners, you want to like smooth it out so much that the brush stroke's invisible. So it's a good challenge, you know, and you can make a painting pretty quick, about 30 minutes. But it's good, it kind of teaches you not to fuss too much over your brush strokes. And it's interesting, you can get them in approximately the right location. The illusion should work. Shadows over a form, and it's really interesting to see how the shadow just curves around the form of the arm. It sort of reveals the bicep, that little indentation in the form of the bicep, and it wraps back around. So that cross the contour is interesting, you know, with that light shadow kind of revealing the form. Generally, you want to start with like your big areas of shapes. You know, that's all worked out in the underpainting. So, you know, these maps of color, I can focus on some of these smaller areas first. Plus, the nice thing about this lighting is that, you know, I always like trying to reveal more form than is there, right? Like the three-dimensional quality, that illusion. So you get that light coming in, and right as it turns from the light to the shadow, that's when you get through your darkest shadow spot, that shadow core. Right as the light stops and that shadow begins. Heel here. It's still in shadow, it's just reflected light from the shadow. So I don't want to make that heel as light as the light area. Still in shadow. It's a lighter color of the shadow.
greater.
Yeah, the air compressor.
That same color kind of shows up over here. You know, so working in one, you know, with one range of color to start, like I'm working on all the shadows and tones for the skin. You know, it's nice because I have a base kind of mixed up first, like a big base of color, and then I can change that a little bit this way, a little bit darker, a little bit lighter. It allows for color harmony to happen, right? So the color and the shadow of the skin is similar throughout the whole painting, right? It has a harmony to it because it has that same sort of common base color. And I try not to use black at all for mixing shadows. I'm trying to help my daughter on a painting the other day. She's doing this crazy complicated self-portrait with like five different reflections. Reflections on the windshield, and it's just, it's very complicated. Painting, using black to make the shadows on the skin, it just sticks out because it's not, she didn't use it anywhere else. So it lacks that kind of that harmony. There's one spot of black, and it's like, yeah, that kind of sticks out. I hope she fixed it today. So when you're mixing shadows, you use complementary colors. Get your, I like the blue-orange combination's nice, some browns, that's the red-green combination I'm going for skin tones. So they sort of neutralize each other and give you a good sort of chromatic shadow color. Shadow here from the skin getting too purple, add a little yellow, neutralize the purple. Sometimes, you know, painting can be challenging. Feel like, you know, a couple hours of painting, you feel like you just spent an afternoon taking like a test or an exam. You're like, no, you're just concentrating on it a little bit. So, about that constant. Some days you're like, yeah, I can't, I'm not doing anything right, or I'm not concentrating.
I can see with a computer, it's very handy to do that.
Yeah, to get up close.
Yes.
I find it helpful, and if I'm looking for something else to add to the painting, I assemble a lot of compositions, including animals or other things in a composition. almost create like a collage, sort of sketch for a larger painting. You know, create, you know, find things from different sources.
What photo app do you use?
This is called Photoshop. Blends together. I just want to make that all one color.
In deciding to do a series, did you decide ahead of time how many paintings you would do and what they would be, or are they just evolving?
Well, it just depends. Like this series, 100 Portraits of Worcester, I decided to do 100. Or 100 views of Worcester, right? So it's like, I have a goal, I'm going to try to hit it, get a show. I did like another one of 100 portraits. So if you have a number, it forces you to do it, right? To hit your goal. So it's good. I think it's good to have a number. This series, I just ongoing. Do this part, I'm dead. You know? This whole, like, you know, the whole life there, the painting. So.
Are you originally from Worcester? Or?
I grew up in Auburn.
Okay.
Went to Auburn High School. Went to college in Providence. After Providence, I got a job. When you get out of college, nobody tells you what to do. It's like, it's all up to you. Like, nobody say, you gotta do this, you gotta wake up, you gotta get a job. You know, I don't know, like, you're like, yeah, I should need a job, so. But it's all on you, right? You know? In a weird way, I kind of remember that. Worcester Art Museum was one of the first places I went, you know, so I'm like, oh, it's an art museum, I'll go see what they have. And they're like, well, do you have a, you know, resume? Yeah, here it is. And they're like, oh, have you ever taught kids? I'm like, no. But then they ended up hiring me as a teaching assistant. I did that for like half a year, and then they started giving me classes. So that's how I started teaching. I never really sought out to be a teacher, and then just sort of stuck. For a little while there, I did greeting cards. I worked at a greeting card company in Kentucky called Paramount Greeting Cards. Did design work and illustrations for them.
That was good. That was probably 3 years, 2 or 3 years.
I went back to school to get a master's degree at Lesley, you know, this is in visual arts. So I'm really started painting quite a bit. So I added a little blue. Sometimes things blend together. Like if I can't really see an edge between the two legs there, then it's just gone. The edge is gonna vanish. I'm gonna get rid of it. I'm gonna group them together because they're grouped by their shadow color. The shape is the shadow, not this leg and that leg. If both legs are in shadow, then you know that edge might disappear. Don't try to draw it, you don't see it. You know, it starts to, I get some contrast here. Pop that in, blend it together here, and then it comes back out. And dark somewhere over here. You start doing the lights. So. Yeah, doing greeting cards, you know, making greeting cards was okay. It was kind of weird because you're 6 months, working 6 months ahead, behind. It's a 6 month turnaround. So in July, you're working on Christmas. So in July, you're thinking Christmas. So we're always off here with our holidays. There's a lot of computer work in front of the computer. I knew I didn't like using the computer now. I didn't really like working on a computer so much. So I went back to school with Lesley. For painting there. And then, let's see. Once I worked at the top of middle school for a little bit, it was hard. Took the teacher task, you know, I was looking for jobs teaching. Here and there, I got lucky, got a good gig at Assumption, was there for a bit, about 11 years. And then sort of bounced around a little bit after that, but now I think Bancroft, you know, it's a good fit for me. Working on the lights now, I'm going to try to throw some light in. He's moving the light. I'm gonna start with the white, pop in some red, some yellow. Try to get that warm sunlight showing. So now I kind of split my palette. I'll work on my lights over here. Keep my shadows over there. Brushes, I'll keep my shadow brush there. Grab another brush. Just have to keep cleaning it for my lights.
Is that the same size as your other brush?
Yeah. Some people fuss over brushes. I don't know. I'll use whatever. How they use them is probably far longer. So as I put this on, I'm going to try to very slightly overlap the shadow color. Right? So it's to try to get rid of a hard edge. Try just to overlap that shadow color just a little bit. And if I didn't get it, or if I have too much pigment on my brush, kind of wipe the pigment off, get a cleaner brush, and I'll just try to straddle that edge, just so there's a slight blur, just to blend it, but not too much, just like a shot, kind of go over it, just let those two colors mix at the edge. That helps just keep the painting from feeling like a cutout, like a collage cutout. You know, sort of get those paint colors to kind of just blend between light and shadow. easier sometimes to paint in, like thin lines. You know, see how the shadows are real thin?
Mm.
I kind of like doing the thin lines first because I might go a little too big. And then I can take the surrounding color and try to like overlap and cut in and get like take this brush, a thinner brush, and just once around the edge. Just create a slight blur at the edges. So I'm going to go back and forth. Jeez, that one's very orange. This is where I'm going to use a little medium. It helps getting like a thick.
The whole piece lights up.
Yeah, I was wondering if it does.
Kind of a stiff one.
That might be as high as it goes. Thank you. benefits, I think of oil, and it might be hard to get used to, the fact that it doesn't dry up on me, right? Like, the good thing is that, you know, I have these edges, they stay wet, so I can, once I paint the light in and then the shadow, I can go back and kind of work on the edges as they stay wet. You know, it's a challenge sometimes to keep them all blending together, but ultimately I think it's a benefit. Acrylic, it's really hard, even when you put the drying retardant in, that slows the drying time, it still dries so fast. It's, you know, some people are so good with that, but I like the fact that oil stays wet along the edges. Push the paint around a little bit once it's down. You know, wipe the brush clean. Push the paint around that's already on the surface a little bit.
So you mainly work in oil?
Yeah, no, like this. Yeah, mostly oil. You know, I'll do watercolors, which are fun. I have a watercolor sketchbook I take with me. Just to have to do some paintings, you know, in the open air, travel with, so having some more emotions. As well as a studio, you know, in the studio. Yeah, part of the, you know, I like that blue-green kind of pastel. Well, that was kind of fun, very interesting to try to get. Maybe I add some color in there. Maybe try some blue in the shadow. Break the skin tone. What I try to keep in my at least for reds, I try to keep a warm and a cool red, so cadmium red and alizarin crimson. So the cad red is good for oranges and skin tones. Alizarin crimson is good for mixing like purples. The cerulean blue is a cooler blue, so it makes nice greens, really intense greens. Cool blue, and then the ultramarine is a warm blue. It's good for purples. So I try to keep a warm and a cool red and blue. Yellow, I just go with the lemon yellow or cadmium yellow light. So I can always add a little red to get the warmth in it. So I just do one cadmium yellow. And then I like having one of each secondary, so like having purple on hand and orange and green. So that's sort of what I have here and what I'm working with. So I'm going to go with the that cooler blue color. Which is tough. I might not be able to get it. Exactly. There's gonna be some colors that are gonna fall outside of the mixable color gamut that you have, so you just have to try to get it as close as possible. You know, unless you get like a specialty color, I'm sure there's a specialty color that you can get that you can match that blue. I just add a little orange to the blue. Yeah, so I took that blue color, added orange to it, and then added a lot of white to lighten it. So whenever you're thinking about color, there's three components to a color. Hue, which is, you know, the visible spectrum of light, right? So you think of the rainbow broken up into specific wavelengths of light. So hue is the specific wavelength of light. You know, you see that in rainbow. So you think, okay, my hue here, you know, it's blue. So my starting point might be blue. And then I got to think about its value. So I'm like, oh, is it light blue? Is it dark blue? Might add white to lighten it, right? And then I'm asking myself, what's its saturation? Is it like intense blue, or is it more of a neutral blue? Right. So saturation is the color's difference from neutral gray. So anytime I'm mixing, I'm always thinking of those three things, you know, hue, value, saturation. And those are the three components that would make up a color. So if I think, oh, you know, this is too blue, well, how do I get rid of the blueness? You know, I add a little bit of orange as a complement. So you sort of work your way towards the color. We call it blue in the light, probably mostly white with a touch of blue. You know, really there's no, that's almost pure, like in terms of saturation. And you can actually look too, the color pickers, right? So here it's broken up into CMYK, cyan, magenta, yellow, here in the corner. And I can see the percentage of each, so it's 14% cyan, 2% yellow. So enough yellow to mix in it, so it'll just be, it's almost like pure blue, a little white, or a lot of white to make it white. So I'll take that. white and add a touch. A good blue for this to get that intense kind of pastel would be a phthalo blue. You have to use that. That's really intense. And it makes really nice kind of sky colors. And when you add white to it, it almost makes it more intense. Where when I'm adding white to these colors, it really dulls it down. That's what I got. I didn't bring phthalo blue. I don't typically use it. But if I had it, I might have put this one. I don't know, I didn't, you know. Sometimes you don't realize until you try to mix the color.
And you said sometimes the smaller ones are studies and then you'll make a larger one.
Yeah.
And you learn.
Yeah.
You can change it.
Right, yeah, exactly. You said, oh, I'll get this color, I'll, you know, use that. Change. Yeah. Things change a little, for sure. Yeah. Yeah, sometimes I'm like, oh, I like this, so I'm not going to make a bigger painting of it. I think
yeah.
It's okay. Yeah. I guess it depends on how. Or maybe I have it and then, you know, a year later or so, I decide. So, you know, I take that smaller brush, and if I want to just kind of like push around that transition, you notice I step back a lot, try to see the painting and my reference, you know, or whatever it is I'm working on at that time. I'm zoomed in, see if they match, see how it looks, you can just see how it looks on its own. I always tell students, stand while you're working. So, you know, and I do sit, sometimes I'll sit, but, you know, I'll also stand quite a bit, you know. And standing's nice because it's easy just to step away and get some distance under the thing. Mine's way too clunky. Just put it in here. Basic shadow color. So edges are a big thing, you know, when you're working on a painting. Go back and forth between your edges. Back and forth.
moving fast?
Yes.
Okay.
Try to get the shirt. So, the hue on the shirt, it's like a green. It's a gray too. Greenish gray. And the light. Yeah, it's like a greenish gray, so we can get started. Yellow green. Let's see, gray it out. Sometimes if you're way off, just cut your losses, start over. You know, instead of wasting paint, I have some students that would have some really dark color, and they just keep adding the tube. You're gonna have to add 10 tubes of white just to like stop. Alright, so I'm gonna go back, start with my green, and I think I'm gonna add a blue. When I hold it up, you know, I'm thinking, okay, what's off? Is it the hue? Is it the lightness? Sometimes I can get the lightness, right? The lightness, the value, whether it's light or dark. And but then the hue's off, so I'm like, oh, there's too much what? What is it? It's too blue. So then I know, okay, I'll add something to neutralize that blue. And then maybe I need to add white after that to keep that value. I do this weird thing, I don't know how it's going to show up on the video, where I kind of close one eye and I make this weird face, kind of squint. The color disappears into what you're trying to match. You got it pretty close. So that's what I'm doing. Yeah, I see whatever that edge, I kind of went over the arm a little bit, and, you know, shades, move up the brush with that. Shadowy skin tone color. Because, you know, you want the things to overlap, right? The arm is in front of the shirt. The rest of it might have to go back. Have to go back and then work that edge again. Slight overlap. Right, and that's the benefit of oil paint. You know, I can go pretty easily back into another edge. I can't quite match the color. I know I can match the right value, right? Because that's just adding white and making something darker. So even if the color is a little off, try to match the value. So beneficial having, you know, have the drawing worked out ahead of time in black and white.
Yeah.
turns, here's your shadow core, that's reflecting light from the arm. So I'm going to have a little bit of that skin tone, you know, in that reflective light. On the side there. Might add a little orange to it. Don't want it to be as light.
You want to enlarge the painting, you use a projector?
Yeah, I could use a projector. It's hard though to control the light and then you're in the shadow, you're in the shadow. So sometimes if I have a drawing or painting, I'll just do a grid. I'll just grid in the painting. The small one or the drawing, especially drawings, they're good for that. So if I have a drawing that I've done, just grid it up to a bigger size.
I'm curious as to why you decided to draw the lines in shadow before doing color on like the legs and the dress and so on and the arm.
The lines here?
Yeah.
I
think like that's constrained you somehow.
I find it, because I'm not going to be able to get that line how I want it until I put it in. And then, so I put that line in first, it's a little wobbly, but then I can take that white and I can cut into it and get it nice and thin, where I would never be able to paint it thin. So I'd like save myself just a step. I guess you could do it either way.
No, just...
Yeah, so I like being able to push that white into it to thin it out, and I can get it real thin. By working in the bigger space around it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like it's just a bigger space to work in, so I can, it's how I painted this thing right here. See that the ledge? You know, my first line was big, but then I went in and tried to just thin it out with that bigger shape around it. You know,
Tom.
Yes.
Do you find yourself, because you've done illustration in the past, do you find yourself compartmentalizing the painting a little bit into the illustration a bit?
Yeah, I wouldn't call it illustration, though. I certainly compartmentalize the color aspect. Then I try to work on color, like I said when I started, the skin tones. So I might have just done all the skin tones first. Wipe my palette clean, put new colors down, and then work on blues in the paint, shorts, and then clean my palette, and then work on...
I do it with shapes like that, unfortunately. Yeah. I will take the shapes and break them down sometimes, because I've done illustration in the past.
Okay.
So I will break it down by shape, put it on the canvas, and then go back and do the same thing with the colors. It's a bad habit, I think, that I have to break sometimes.
I don't know. I wouldn't say it's a bad habit. I mean, you simplify something that's really complicated, you know? I think this was years ago, I was reading about Rembrandt, you know, when I was in graduate school studying those artists. You know, it was interesting looking at their palettes in their paintings. Like, so when Rembrandt did a self-portrait, he got his palette. And you learn about what colors he used by seeing his palettes. And so there's that theory that he would sort of compartmentalize his color that way instead of working. Because I was taught, at art school, you know, paint the whole thing all at once, all at the same time. And end up with like a mud patch. And so when I read about that idea, sort of just working, you know, having one palette for this set of colors, and then cleaning your palette, putting down a new set that you're going to work on that's a little separate, that's, you know, different color range. I think it just helped me with my color, kept my color from getting contaminated on my palette, right? Because then you're trying to squeeze, you know. I'm trying to squeeze colors in here, and I'm thinking, geez, you know, I'd like to change out my palette now. And so sometimes, like, knowing when to do that, like, instead of trying to say, oh, you know, I don't know, some of my white is working more white out, and I got yellow in it, I can make it work, but then I'm like, well, I should clean it out. So I think it's helped me with color. Like, I don't necessarily think it's good with that. Well, I guess you could do what works for you and what your vision is for that painting, you know? And it's just, it's helped me. Just with studio practices, and I suppose, you know, keeping things from getting contaminated, keeping your lights light. And then being able to, when it's in the painting, since all the edges are wet, I can go back and I can blend between edges if I need to.
Are you at a good stopping point now?
We're at 9 o'clock, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Photos, drawings. Yeah. 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 Yeah.